Good morning, my dear friends. Today I am going to talk about the disorders mainly related to gastrointestinal tract, or also we call it is a gut related disorders. First I talk about salivary glands. There is a one term called sialorrhea or tialism, that's called increased flow of saliva in termed sialorrhea or tialism. Mainly the diseases which we see the increased production of saliva are stomatitis, even mentally retarded status, schizophrenia, psychological disorders, neurological disturbances, and increased gastric secretion. Same way, there is a one more term related to salivary glands, that is xerostomia. Decreased salivary flow is termed as xerostomia. The diseases which we see xerostomia are sarcoidosis, mumps, parotitis, megaloblastic anemia, dehydration, and any other narcotic drug intake. There is a one term called as sialadenitis, that is inflammation of salivary glands. It may be acute or chronic. So there are different particular microorganisms which causes sialadenitis, that is viral involvement, mainly seen in parotitis, orchitis, oophoritis, and pancreatitis. In case of bacterial and mycotic infection, mainly in case of acute infectious fevers, acute post-operative parotitis, general debility, old age, and in case of dehydration. Even some of the autoimmune diseases also causes sialadenitis. There is a one tumor which is mainly related to salivary glands, that we call it as a pleomorphic adenoma, or also called as mixed salivary tumor. Common tumor of major salivary glands, means salivary glands are divided into two types, one is major and one more is minor. This is one of the commonest tumor of major salivary glands that contributes nearly 60 to 75%, and minor salivary glands involvement is 50%. It is the commonest tumor in the parotid gland and occurs less often in other major and minor salivary glands. Tumor is very common in women at the age of 30 to 50 years. The tumor is very solitary, smooth surfaced, sometimes nodular, painless, and slow growing. It is often located just below and in front of the ear with a huge mass. The morphological features are grossly, when you see the cut surface of this tumor, it is well circumscribed, pseudo encapsulated, rounded, at times it will be multilobulated, firm mass nearly 2 to 5 cm in diameter with particular surface. The cut surface is grey, white, and bluish in color, semi translucent, usually solid, but occasionally may show some cystic spaces. The consistency is very soft and mucoid, means rich in mucus. Microscopically, when we look at the tumor, there is a mixed appearance in which there are epithelial elements present in a matrix of mucoid solution or myxoid and chondroid tissue. Prognosis is notorious for reoccurrence. Tumor is entirely benign in nature, so it will not harm, it can be surgically removed, but the reoccurrence chances are more. Let's talk now in relation with the gastrointestinal tract. There is a one term called as cardiospasm, or also called as achalasia. The achalasia is one of the esophagus in a neuromuscular dysfunction, due to which the cardiac sphincters fails to relax during swallowing and results in progressive dysphagia, that means painful swallowing reflex, and dilatation of the esophagus that leads to mega esophagus. There is a term called as hiatus hernia. It is the herniation or bulbar enlargement or protrusion of the part of the stomach through the esophageal hiatus of the diaphragm. This esophageal hiatal hernia is the cause of diaphragmatic hernia in 98% of the cases. it will be diagnosed radiologically in about 5% of the cases. There are different types of this iatus hernia. One is sliding esophageal gastric type, that will be slided over the just above the abdomen stomach area, and rolling, that is paraesophageal type, and mixed, that is transitional type. There is one more condition called as Barrett's esophagus, that is following reflex esophagitis, there is a stratified squamous epithelium of the lower esophagus is replaced by columnar epithelium, also called as columnar metaplasia. This seen in later age, caused by factors producing GERD, gastroesophageal reflux diseases. It is a pre-malignant condition evolving sequentially from Barrett's epithelium. That means the columnar metaplasia that leads to dysplasia, thereby leads to carcinoma in the particular cell, that is carcinoma in situ, then finally leads to esophageal adenocarcinoma. Morphological features, endoscopically when we see the particular area, the affected area is red and velvety. Iatus hernia and peptic ulcer at squamocolumnar junction is commonest feature when we see through the endoscopy, that is called as Barrett's ulcers, are frequently associated. When we look at the microscopical exam part, replacement of squamous epithelium by metaplastic columnar cells. Barrett's esophagus may be composed of intestinal epithelium, fundic gastric glands, or cardiac mucous glands. Other cells like goblet cells, chief cells, parietal cells, mucus secreting cells, and endocrine cells will be seen through the microscopy. Then endoscopic biopsies are advised because Barrett's intestinal metaplasia may develop dysplasia. High grade dysplasia may progress to invasive adenocarcinoma of the esophagus in up to 20% of the cases. There is one condition called as gastritis. It is commonly employed for any clinical condition with upper abdominal discomfort like indigestion or dyspepsia, in which the specific clinical signs and radiological abnormalities are present. There are two types of gastritis, acute and chronic. Acute gastritis, it is a transient mucosal inflammatory process. There may be asymptomatic or cause variable degree of epigastric pain, nausea, and vomiting. In more severe cases, there may be mucosal erosion, ulceration, hemorrhage, hematemesis, melena, or rarely massive blood loss. The meaning of hematemesis is vomiting of the blood or the food contents, which are turned into coffee ground in color.